Hello and welcome everybody, King Dempz back at it again, and today we are talking about MBK and his recent removal from the MOUZ starting lineup. Now, I want to preface this by saying I did do a written piece about this on HLTV. I'll link that down in the description. And if you've read that, then you don't really need to watch this video. I'm not going to talk about anything new in the video. I just wanted to put it in video form for people who, you know, maybe follow my channel and don't follow HLTV, or who, you know, don't read long articles, because it was pretty long. Probably try and make those opinion pieces shorter in the future. Now, I want to open by saying that I was shocked by this decision, as I think a lot of the Counter-Strike world was. MOUZ had started reasonably well with MBK in the lineup. They got through the Katowice play-in and they did get knocked out of the tournament proper, but they were competitive in the games that they did play. If we just scroll down here, you know, as you can see, they beat OG. They were competitive, very competitive against Vitality, which was not a bad result at all. And obviously, as you can see, they actually had some pretty impressive results in the play-in. They, again, were competitive with FaZe, took a map off them, ran them very close in the decider, and beat Entropic 2-0 to make it out of the play-in. So, you know, all in all, it was pretty decent results if we look at Katowice. I think ESL Pro League was a little bit disappointing. They took a win off G2, obviously G2 with a stand-in, but then they lost to NiP, which wasn't the end of the world. Again, they were competitive in the series, took a map. NiP have honestly been looking pretty solid so far this year, surprisingly solid with Fuzi in the lineup. It's this game that is probably the most disappointing for MOUZ. Maybe the Entropic game, because they beat Entropic Katowice play-in, so they'd kind of proven they could do it. But I think it will definitely be the Fnatic game. Fnatic coming into this event, obviously, with Pepsol and Banjo in the lineup. No disrespect to those players, but they have no experience in the top level of Counter-Strike. Fnatic had basically cobbled together a lineup at short notice due to a lot of issues. Crims being ill, Brolan not playing, Smooya being kicked. So, you know, MOUZ would have probably hoped to at least have won that Fnatic game. So yeah, I can understand why the ESL Pro League was probably a smidge disappointing, but it was their first go with the proper lineup. Obviously, JDC stepped in for Bemis at Katowice, Bemis came back for EPL, and it, yeah, for a first outing, it wasn't bad at all. It really wasn't that bad. And then, kind of out of nowhere, MBK gets kicked straight after the event. Gets kicked in favour of JDC, who obviously stood in for BMAS at Katowice, as previously mentioned. And here we are. Now, as I've said, I don't think MOUZ as a team were doing that badly. I think it looked okay. It looked like there was kind of a proof of concept there. They had some decent results. There was a realm in which you could understand this team doing well. MBK himself was, you know, variable. He wasn't smashing out of the park, but actually was putting in some pretty good performances and, you know, dropping 30 against Vitality in overtime, probably not something that MOUZ would expect from MBK. You know, putting in like a 1.55 against NiP on an OT game to get them over the line. You know, there's a lot of performances here that were really, really impressive in individual maps. Yes, the overall was like slightly below average. I think he averaged just under a 1.00 rating for the period. If we just do it here, actually, we can just have a quick look. Yeah, so a 0.97 for the period. But half of his maps, roughly a little bit less, being over a 1 rating, you know, 1 over half of them. It's not looking too bad, really, from a personal, just a purely statistical raw, you know, ratings, KDs, differentials. It's not looking super terrible for MBK. And considering the role he was being put in, which we'll talk about in a second, it was actually even more impressive, really. So these are the statistics from the Katowice play-in, and I think something to notice here is that MBK is taking the most opening duels out of anybody in the game, even with anybody on the team, sorry. Even with JDC in the lineup, there is still more attempts coming from MBK, and he's a lot more successful, so he was doing pretty well in like a very aggressive role. And this is for the event proper. So this is for actual Katowice, not the play-in. As you can see here, this is the Katowice main event, not the play-in. MBK was absolutely smashing it. Again, he was having the most opening attempts. He was having a very good success rate. And his opening rating was actually really impressive. So As you can see, MBK was taking a very aggressive stance in general. He was looking to create space and be the spearhead so that the younger, maybe slightly more mechanically gifted at this point in their careers, those players could come through and get the business done. Now, not only was MBK brought in to be a player on this team, but he was also brought in to be a leader. If I just give you a little smidgen of a quote here, this is from the CEO of MOUZ upon signing NBK. He said that basically they knew replacing Rops skill-wise would, and this is a direct quote, be an impossible task. So we looked for a player that can lead our younger players. So that makes a lot of sense. I think when you look at this MOUZ lineup, they lost Rops, who despite his young age was actually incredibly experienced at tier one. Obviously, before they lost Rops this offseason, the kind of previous year, they'd lost Carrigan, a very storied and very experienced in-game leader. And the replacements that have come in for these players have been players like Torzy, no experience at Tier 1 before he started playing, obviously, with this MOUZ lineup. We've got players around Torzy, such as Beamus and Frozen, who are both very, very young. Frozen, yes, a little bit of experience at Tier 1, but very, very young players. Players who probably need some older, calmer, wiser heads around them to help them out. And bringing MBK in seemed to address some of those issues. MBK, one of the most storied players in our game, won over 20 LAN trophies in CSGO, been in the best players in the world list. Let's just have a look. Yep, so here we can see just the raft of achievements. You know, fifth best player in the world in 2013, on the list low down in 2014, up there in 2015. So he spent a few years early on in the game as one of the best players in it, won lots of tournaments, has tournament MVPs to his name, quite a few from, again, earlier on in the game. 2015 is around the time MBK started to fall off a little bit. Well, going into 2016 as one of the best players in the world. But still, obviously very experienced, a lot of veteran smarts that he can bring to the lineup. And that seemed to be what MBK was going to do. If you look at it beforehand, he was going to provide experience. He was going to provide a level head. He was going to provide experienced head. And then he came into the team as a player on the server to be a spearhead for his team, to open up space for the younger players around him, like I've said. Honestly, it made a lot of sense, and it was panning out in a way that seemed to make sense. Now, this is the man that was brought in or has been brought in to replace MBK, and these are his stats from the Katowice play-in. And I think this event, on balance, is probably what gave MOUZ the impetus to make this change. JDC was very, very, very good at the Katowice play-in. If we just have a look at some of the matches that he played, his only negative rating was against FaZe on Inferno. Everything else was pretty good. And his series, in particular against Entropic, was huge. He was very, very influential. He was a big-time player in that series. And in general, as you can see, his performances were pretty good, putting up lots of frags. He was also, as we saw when we looked at MBK stats, he was generally playing a more aggressive role, playing for entries. And in a similar kind of role to MBK, was obviously performing him or outperforming him, sorry, statistically at the play-in. The problem is, when we got to the event proper, JDC sucked the bag pretty hard. He was atrocious at the main event. If we look at the matches, he was abysmal in the Vitality series, actually probably a big difference maker in a negative sense for MOUZ. If JDC had performed anything like the level he did at the play-in, then honestly, there's a good chance that MOUZ win that series against Vitality. He was also not too great in the NiP series, and he was okay in the OG series, definitely better, but again, not really a super influential player. He basically fell off a cliff when the event proper came around. Just really was not very good. Just to provide the comparison points, these are MBK's overall stats from the play-in. And if we just go back here, these are obviously JDC's. So if we swap between the two, we can see obviously at the play-in, JDC absolutely wiping the floor with MBK statistically. Pretty much better in every aspect. However, if we move over to the main event, where obviously JDC had a bit of a stinker, NBK was a lot more reliable come the proper event. And actually, that 1.11 impact rating from Katowice, the main event, is actually very impressive. NBK was also involved in some important clutches during that event. So yeah, I think Katowice, the play-in showed the proof of concept where JDC can be a lot more influential statistically than NBK, playing a similar role. However, the Katowice main event suggested JDC probably needs some time to develop, probably wasn't quite ready for a major LAN just yet. So, I don't know, I'm kind of weighing it up there and like, on the basis of Katowice, yes, you probably stick with NBK for now. And then I'm guessing the EPL disappointment is kind of what caused MOUZ to pull the trigger. The thing is, the fact that MOUZ pulled the trigger so quickly after one very mildly disappointing event where it was the first with the full lineup, yeah, it probably means that, let's be realistic, MOUZ were looking to make this change anyway. That's probably fair enough. Now, I think if we go back to looking at this, which was obviously the play-in statistics, one more time, the other aspect I want you to kind of look at and focus on, and I think this is a very important point to consider, is Torzy. Obviously, absolutely smashing it for MOUZ, has in general been playing very well. It's not been like overwhelmingly, oh my God, Torzy's one of the best players in the world. Now, no, he's looked very good in patches. He's also had some very quiet games. Overall, though, it's been promising, and he has definitely more than one occasion has demonstrated his hard carry potential, his potential to have huge impact, his potential to post big stats. Essentially, Torzy's promotion has so far been a success. I'm sure he will get more consistent with more experience at tier one. I think he is going to be a quality tier one player for years to come. Now, I think that is a very, very important aspect to mention. So Torzy's promotion was a success. It shows MOUZ that promotion from the academy roster is very possible and very well could be the future for a MOUZ lineup that probably doesn't have the cash to go out and make mega signings very often. Now, I think another important piece of information to remember and to keep in our heads when discussing MBK's eventual removal is the fact that Cyclone, the MOUZ NXT head coach, was promoted to MOUZ's head coach roughly the same time MBK was brought on board. Now, we have to start doing a little bit of speculation here and filling in the gaps, but it would be safe to assume, because Cyclone was brought on board around the same time as NBK, he probably wasn't involved all too much in the NBK signing. He probably had some sort of, let's say, advisory kind of capacity when it came to the NBK signing. He was probably asked his opinion in some form, I would suggest. But I doubt he had as much influence over the lineup as he does now a few months into his tenure. Now, what is the timeline kind of tell me? Cyclone comes in same time as NBK. Look, I think if Cyclone had been the head coach, let's say, of MOUZ, I don't know, for like 2 months, 3 months beforehand, maybe he'd made the transition from MOUZ NXT early to put his imprint on the squad, to have more input in building the next version of MOUZ, I don't think NBK would have ever been signed. I think if you look at the timeline, it can't be a coincidence that once the MOUZ Academy coach has time to embed himself in the first team and probably has more influence, that almost straight away JDC is brought into the lineup. Another one of his Academy players. I think adding everything together, it looks like NBK was probably facing a bit of an uphill battle from the very start. I think the Academy head coach being brought into the main team, his star AWPA kind of going with him in terms of promotion and then also being a success, the org was probably going to be sat there thinking like, you know, the Academy project is a success anyway. That's why we're promoting these two. Now that these two have kind of come into the team and had some success, Jesus, why don't we just go even harder and commit even further to utilizing the Academy project? And that's what MOUZ have done. And it's not surprising in some senses, but it is, I think, most definitely harsh on NBK. I think he had performed pretty well, all things considered. He was doing his job. And the intangible, and what I mean by that is the aspect that we can't really look and see statistically or even look at a demo and kind of gauge with the eye test. You have to be inside the team to understand this contribution is what was MBK contributing outside of the server in terms of experience, in terms of level-headedness, in terms of his influence on the atmosphere within the team. Now, it's hard to say, but there is one thing I think it is worth looking at. Hi guys, same video, different day. As you can tell by the change of t-shirt, unfortunately my OBS decided to grief me the other day and ruin the end of the recording. But this is basically the last thing I wanted to show you anyway, and then we'll quickly summarize my points. But essentially, I want to focus on this paragraph of the news post relating to JDC replacing MBK. After a disappointing EPL, obviously that's the first aspect to look at. This is the excuse. I think it's a pretty weak one, honestly, that there have to be a lot of other reasons because EPL was the first chance with the lineup and it wasn't that bad. So yeah, it's a bit of a weak excuse, I think, in my eyes. But the bit I think that is very interesting is this. The fact that Cyclone emphasizes JDC's attitude, positivity, and communication, rather than referencing mechanics or stats or we think he'll be a better entry fragger, none of that was said. What has been said is basically all focused around JDC's interaction with the rest of the team. Now, I understand and I am aware that everything that's come out publicly has been people talking positively about MBK. There was an exchange on Twitter, you can go and look it up, where MBK and Dexter had some positive interactions. And according to what MBK says, he's only received positive feedback. I believe him on that front, but I don't understand why you frame it in this way if the issue was mechanical or the thought was that the ceiling would be high with JDC. Say that. Don't talk about attitude, positivity, and communication, because obviously people are going to speculate and are going to assume that MBK had something going on behind the scenes, i.e. MBK was toxic. I'm not saying he was, but that is what is being insinuated by this kind of communication. And also we have to bring in considerations about MBK's past. So Vitality and OG, the last two teams MBK played on, XTaz came out in an interview, you can go and search it up on HLTV, after MBK left Vitality and said it was either Alex or MBK, that basically those two were clashing, insinuated that there was some ego problems. And then on OG, I think the phrase that was used in the report about NBK leaving OG was that there was a difference in vision about the game, which basically, again, means people are disagreeing outside of the server. It's nothing to do with mechanics or exactly what's happening in the server. It's much more to do with communication, personality, clashes, etc. outside the server. I understand also NBK came out and denied the speculation in a tweet. He said, look, I've seen speculation. I was a great teammate, blah, blah, blah. I'm not saying MBK definitely wasn't. I have no particular insight. What I am doing is making inferences and making assumptions based on the information available. And those are the assumptions you have to make. I'm sorry, there's no other way to kind of look at it, the information that we have available. That's it from me, guys, for this video. Just a quick summary. Basically, I think MBK was doomed from the start. I don't think he did anything to warrant getting benched. However, the fact he was benched means you have to look at the kind of surrounding context and circumstances. And I think Cyclone, the academy head coach, becoming the main team head coach, Torzy's promotion being a success, in general, the academy project being a success, I think MBK's days on MOUZ were seriously numbered. I think the second the team dipped in form or MBK dipped in form, he was probably going to be gone. And I don't think it's MBK's fault. I think the signs were looking pretty decent with him on the roster, and he never really got a shot with the five-man lineup, the full five-man lineup, particularly, again, considering some of the rounding context, like Bemis was switching roles. You're trying to embed Torzy, who, yes, has looked good, but it's not been consistent. He's had some stinkers as well and definitely needs time to adjust and become more consistent. And considering he was in an aggressive role as, let's say, not a mechanically standout player, he was doing really well from that aggressive role. So I hope NBK can find another team. I hope that we see more of the Kingmaker in Counter-Strike. He's one of our legends. The scene is more interesting and richer, I think, when he is present. So I hope for the game's sake that NBK can find another team, because I was actually pretty excited about what he was bringing to the roster. It was looking quite promising by my reckoning. You know the drill, guys. Like it. Drop me a comment because it helps me out. Subscribe if you haven't already. And if you did not like the video, I'm not angry. I'm just disappointed.